Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Friday Robotics Colloquium. It's just a pleasure to have you all here. Particularly excited to welcome Mehmet Dogar today, Professor Mehmet Dogar from the University of Leeds. Mehmet got his PhD at the Robotics Institute in 2013. Subsequently went off to do a postdoc at MIT with Daniela Rus. Worked on some really cool multi-agent furniture assembly work that got a lot of really good press and really good work. And then after that, went off and became a faculty at Leeds. So a couple of things about Mehmet. One is I believe that he's from the same school as Maya, and they were both classmates or a year apart. Incredibly grateful to that school for producing superstars and continuing to produce superstars. And secondly, of course, Mehmet was one of my first early PhD students. And so we've spent a lot of time together hacking robots, hacking Herb. And I think I'm really grateful personally to Mehmet for all the friendship as well as all the work that we did together in building the personal robotics lab from sort of the ground up, from when we had zero robots to where we are now. So it's been a great journey. And of course, like, I haven't heard Mehmet talk in a few years now, and I can already see that he's changed the font from my prescribed font. So he's already demonstrating great independence. I have a deep distaste for sans serif fonts. Without further ado, Mehmet, and looking forward.
Thank you, Sid. So yeah, I mean, as I was working on this one, I had pictures, and like, I was like, okay, Sid is going to really get stuck on this one. Like, you know, why is that?
You still hear your PhD supervisor speaking to you when you work, right? So that is definitely there, and you are always with me, Sid, like, you know, in my mind, telling me what to do and what not to do. So thank you for inviting me all to this seminar. And I will try to tell a bit about what we have been working on recently. And my research area is object manipulation, and not a surprise given that I was Sid's PhD student. And I will really try to talk about two things today. And the first one is about physics-based object manipulation. And I am interested in tasks like reaching, you know, there's this robot, it reaches in to grasp this object with the green tape on it, let's say, and then it needs to push through these objects, it needs to predict how the objects move and push on each other, and then it needs to make physics-based predictions to do that. So that is one topic that I will talk about. And within this topic, the main message today that I want to focus on will be that I think to perform physics-based object manipulation, we really need hierarchical physics models. That will be something that I will try to convey. What I mean by hierarchical physics models is that let's say, you know, we have a scene like that, and there's a box, and there are items in there, some rigid items, some deformable items like this teddy bear here. And, you know, let's say this robot wants to reach for this object with the star on it. What we usually do is we try to model the scene in some accurate high resolution way, right? For example, in a physics engine. And then we use physics predictions to then plan. I will try to suggest that actually for some tasks, the accuracy, the level of detail, the dimensionality of the representation should be different. And it would be great if we can have coarse physics models which are lower dimensional, which work on lower dimensional representations of the states of these representations, or there can also be lower accuracy with respect to these, because some tasks just don't need that accuracy, or some tasks don't need that high dimensionality. So that will be one of the main messages that I will try to convey. The second topic that I will talk about today, and it will be, you know, quite a big jump. I'm sorry about that, but you know, there will only be two, so it's not too bad, hopefully. The second topic I will talk about is human-robot forceful collaboration. When I say forceful collaboration, for example, I am thinking of a task where a human is trying to cut a hole, a circle on a board like this, let's say. And then it is the robot's job to grasp that board and hold it for the human such that the board is stable, everything is stable at the robot's joints, but also that the interaction is fluent and the human is comfortable. And there, the main point that I will, the main message that I will try to convey is that actually to be able to perform these kind of planning with where there's forceful interaction with the human, we should start thinking about the human biomechanics and really thinking about what is going on at the musculoskeletal level in the human body to be able to plan comfortable interactions. Okay, so those are the two messages that I will try to now give more detail, but those will be the main points really. Okay, so, and we will start with the physics-based object manipulation one. Now, as Sid said, I was a PhD student with him, and one of the things that we worked on back then was this planner. We were interested in developing, going beyond collision-free motion planning and building planners that can predict how objects move as the robot makes its plans so that the robot can interact with objects, not only through grasping, but also pushing, and so that robots can reach through clutter. And we worked on these planners, but one of the important aspects and limitations of these planners were that they were open loop. So the robot would plan and it would just close its eyes and execute. And one consequence of this was that the scenes had to be relatively sparse. When multiple objects contacted each other, the predictions, the long horizon predictions of the open loop plans could really fail, and then the plans would not lead to success. So, for example, in a scene like this, again, you know, this is the original scene that I showed, where the robot is trying to reach for this green object here. If you make an open loop plan, for example, you can plan an action sequence like this, where it gets to the green object. But when you try to execute it, the errors accumulate, and then you can very easily end up with failure. Okay, so because of that, when I because in using these original planners, we weren't able to really reach into these cluttered spaces where multiple objects are contacting each other. One thing that I wanted to do when I moved to Leeds, started thinking about what problems to work on, was I wanted to convert these planners into closed loop manipulation planners, right? So I got interested in that, and the way I first approached this problem was, you know, very straightforward, the approach that many people would take really, which was online replanning or model predictive control, you can call it. So let's say your robot makes a plan. Let's say the plan is represented by this yellow line. What we do is we don't really close the eyes of the robot and execute it all the way, but we execute it for a short duration. And then we perceive the environment again, sense where all these objects are, update our model. And then if necessary, we rerun the planning, and then we update our plan, and then we continue execution like that, right? And to implement this, we have taken the trajectory optimization approach. We would initialize with a straight line trajectory, and we would then specify a cost function where there would be terminal goal costs about where the object is relative to the inside of the hand. There will also be costs along the time steps, like acceleration costs or edge costs, which prevents the objects approaching to the edges of the table too much. And so, you know, this was pretty straightforward trajectory optimization and a rerunning in model predictive control. And when we tried these planners, it was actually able to deal with a higher amount of clutter. So where objects could push onto each other because it was able to update these plans. And another, the previous video was like 3 times speed. So this is actually, you know, the real time, so that you can see actually how slow it is as well. But another difference here is that there are the edges of the shelf, which is a problem. If there's jamming, it can actually result in likely failure in these cases. This is the case where it succeeds, but those static obstacles can be problematic. But you know, there were so we saw that it was possible to actually make these planners work in a slightly higher amount of clutter. But you know, there were still many limitations of this approach. One of them was that it was still very slow. Okay. Second, of course, these trajectory optimizers are working locally. So if the problem wasn't locally solvable, then we would have to reinitialize the trajectory at some other initial trajectory. And you know, if you want to do that, then actually it can get even slower, right? So that is that still connects to the slowness problem. We were assuming full observability, right? We had those mocap markers on those objects. And not only that, we assume we can see all the objects because we have a top-down view, but also the mocap markers give us very high accuracy pose of those objects. So for example, you know, if you look into this fridge, you don't have neither of those, right? So you are not seeing all the objects, and even if you see the objects, you don't have mocap markers, so your estimates will be about their pose will have some uncertainty associated with them. So the thing is, if we want to go to partial observability, what we would need to do is to, for example, if we want to do a belief space planning instead of just assuming that we know the state, then that would actually make the planner even slower, right? Because, you know, taking a Monte Carlo approach, you would need to propagate even more possible states forward. And then another limitation that I just mentioned about was that static obstacles were still very problematic for us, and jamming kind of interactions where the physics is difficult to predict was problematic. But when we looked at these limitations after we did that initial work, when we looked at these limitations and thought about what to focus on next, we said, okay, so the real bottleneck, I mean, the most important bottleneck here is the computational expense of the physics model. Because, you know, as I said, the system is slow, and also there are some features that are missing. And if you want to include those features, they will make the system even slower. And the most slow part of this whole system is running the physics model forward, predicting how the objects will move. Okay. And so we asked the question, okay, how can we make the physics model faster? Well, we said, okay, so how accurate do we really need the physics predictions to be, was then the question we asked. Because if, let's say, we have this system dynamics, this is the physics model, right? So the state, the controls, and how it evolves, let's say it is represented by F, the system dynamics here. You know, think of this as integrating this forward. Every time you're doing a physics prediction, you are basically doing numerical integration, right? So we were thinking maybe we can trade off accuracy of this integration with computational speed. If we don't need to be very accurate with certain tasks, trade off from accuracy, we can then increase the speed, was something that we thought. And if you think about it, if we have the system dynamics, the thing is, we can integrate it more accurately, and then the computational expense will be higher, or we can integrate it less accurately, and computationally it may be cheaper. And then the important thing to observe here is that there is probably some useless accuracy here, right? That was the thing that got us thinking about this. There's some useless accuracy here. why is there useless accuracy? There are multiple aspects of this, I think, and I like to think about this. So, you know, so for example, one thing that contributes to this is that your model, right, F, is not the real world. So there is a discrepancy between your model and the real world. And then, you know, as you are integrating your model, very finely, you are overfitting to your model, but it is not a good representation of the real world anyway. So if your model is, you know, 1 centimeter off with respect to the real world, well, you can actually integrate to an accuracy of 1 centimeter as well, because, you know, more accuracy is not going to pay you off in the real world, right? Now, this is true even if the real world is deterministic. But the real world is not deterministic. The real world itself is stochastic, right? So there is this great work by Yu et al. This is from Alberto Rodriguez group at MIT, where they push the same object thousands of times, and they show that, you know, up to the degree that they can control and observe, sense this object, every time they push it, it moves differently. So then there's some useless accuracy coming from the integration of this model there as well, because, you know, if the real world is behaving differently every time, then, you know, why are you trying to be much more accurate than that? But more important than this too, I think, is that there is the task, given a task, there are the requirements of that task, right? And every task is different in that respect. Like some examples that I like to think about here is, for example, imagine yourself in the kitchen reaching into your cabinet with the wine glasses, right? There, you really need to be accurate about your predictions, because you don't want anything to fall off. You don't want to apply too much force, because things can break. And compare that with when you reach into your drawer for utensils when you are trying to grab a knife, right? Where your predictions about how you contact those other knives and forks are quite loose, and you don't necessarily need to make very accurate predictions. So the accuracy of the required prediction can change based on the task. And of course, you know, one question is, given a task, how do you find that? How do you find where, what is the coarseness level which you can work with? And so we did some initial work on this where we looked at, okay, how can we actually adapt to the required task accuracy? And these were some example tasks that we came up with. I like them because I think they give the idea quite nicely. So this is the same controller in both cases. We don't tell it the required accuracy. We just specify it the task. And it is the same task, but here the robot has to push it on this narrow strip to this small green circle, whereas here it needs to push it on this large table where it is much more difficult for the object to fall down, and the goal region is also much larger. And, you know, this is a high accuracy task, and this is a low accuracy task, and basically the system starts with the low accuracy physics model, okay? And when it evaluates it, it basically sees that in this task, there are lots of failures. So it gradually refines its physics model. But here, you know, the low accuracy physics model is fine. So, you know, it just goes ahead with it. And this was one example of how, you know, you can actually during planning adapt to that. Now, but, and here we really had, we were looking at how to adapt to that, but we were also interested in, okay, how do we actually create these different physics models, right? So because ideally what we want is a hierarchy of physics models. So at the bottom, we have the very fine model, right? This is the full accuracy model. Let's say, you know, you take your favorite physics engine, and in many of these works, we use Mujoko. So let me say Mujoko, but you can replace it with any physics engine. Let's say this is running Mujoko, at a fine resolution, and then we at the top we have very coarse predictions about how the physics evolves, and these coarse models are less accurate but cheaper, and fine models are more accurate but expensive, and we want a whole spectrum in between, right? Because different tasks will require planning at a different level here. So ideally we want a really good, nice spectrum here. One question was, okay, how to generate such a spectrum of models? How to generate such a spectrum of physics models? A straightforward answer could be okay, play with the integration step size, right? So, you know, when you are running your physics engine, you can go and, you know, whether it is doing earlier integration or running your cutter integration, whatever, you can actually make the step size larger. And as you make the step size larger, you will get less accurate integrations. And, but, you know, it will be computationally cheaper. But, you know, this is actually not a great way to try to build such a hierarchy, because these numerical integrations can get unstable very quickly as you increase the step size. And, you know, when we tried that, we weren't able to move up in this hierarchy. We were really at the bottom. And actually, when you are running your physics engine, especially with rigid objects, really you should run your physics engine at the largest time step before it starts being unstable, like even the finest model, because, you know, any finer than that is not going to be relevant to the real world dynamics anyway. So just making the integration step size larger was not a way we could do that. So we looked at other options, and then we came across this thing called parallel in time integration. Okay, so with parallel in time integration, you do not only have a fine model, but you also need a coarse model. Okay, so it requires also a coarse model, but only one. And what you can do is you can combine the two through parallelization to create a hierarchy of models, which is exactly what we wanted. So you can pay more computational time to get more accuracy, and you can navigate between these two. Okay. And the way this works is, I will try to explain using this example where we have this pusher, cylinder, and this box. Let's say we are pushing it, and, you know, what we want to do is predict the states, and the states are the positions of this box. And this is the actual fine integration that you make, let's say. So let's say this is time, and then this is the state. This is not real data. This is just illustration, obviously. So pay too much attention to its exact shape, but let's say this is the fine integration forward, and you do not want to do this, right? So what you don't want is take the fine model, take, you know, Mujoko, and integrate it all the way until the end. That is not what you want. What you want to do is with parallel in time integration, you use the coarse model to somehow divide this into slices. And then you run each of those slices on parallel cores using the fine model. And then you try to combine them in an intelligent way to get a better estimate of this function, okay? And, so this line here, let's say, represents, I should have shown this before. This line here represents how your object actually moves with your fine model, right? Let's say this is running Mujoko forward all through the time horizon. Okay. Now, as I said, what we want to do though is we want to divide this into slices. Let's say here we divide this into four slices. And then what you do with parallel in time integration is, so we are trying to get to this curve, right? This is what we want to achieve, but we don't want to pay the full price. So what you do is you run a coarse model. Okay. So here I'm just illustrating this coarse model as the straight line. It doesn't have to be straight line. And I'll open a parenthesis here. I apologize about this. But, you know, here the coarse model is magically hitting the endpoint of this actual curve, which, you know, is of course not going to happen unless you're very lucky. Just ignore that. It doesn't have to for this explanation. It doesn't have to. That was a mistake. But basically what you do is you run the coarse model, okay? And your coarse model, you can ask, what is a coarse model? For example, for the coarse model here for this pushing case, we implemented something that is very similar to a quasi-static prediction, but even cheaper than that. And as you can see, the green object here is not moving very realistically. It should actually move a bit more left, and it is rotating in place. The thing is, it is super, super fast to compute this, okay? So this is kind of the coarse model. And what you do is you compute, you run over the full horizon using the coarse model. But if your coarse model is almost negligible with respect to the fine model, then you can actually compute these initial points over which you can then run the fine model on parallel cores, right? Given the initial conditions of each slice, you can then run the fine model in parallel cores. And then you don't have to stop here. What you do is you then use the course model, again in a full sweep, to propagate the differences forward. And I won't go into the details. You can look at the paper to see how this propagation happens. But basically, through the course sweep, again, you can have a much better estimate of the underlying function. And this, for example, when we combine that course model with the fine model, for example, after one iteration, this is the predictions that we get for this green box. And this is the prediction after only one iteration. Okay, so now we have an estimate of this function after one iteration, but you can do this again. Basically, you can now start from these points and run again using the fine model on parallel course, and then you can do a course sweep again, and then you will have an even better estimate of the curve. So basically, we have what we want, right? We can pay more computational time to get even better approximations of this underlying function that we want to integrate. And basically, we did this for the single object pushing tasks with the course model that we devised, and we showed that. So here, the vertical axis is the root mean square error of the predictions with respect to the fine model at the full horizon integration, with respect to paying the full price. Okay, and it is log scale, so you can see it goes down quite quickly after one iteration, second iteration, third iteration, and in the fourth iteration, it takes a bit, goes to zero. But at fourth iteration, you are paying the price of full integration anyway. So you know there's no meaning to using a parallel in time integration if you are going to do that many iterations. So ideally, you want to stop somewhere much before. But we showed basically that you know we can actually do a few iterations only, and then use that in pushing planning examples, and they can still work in those tasks, just like the ones I showed at the beginning where we were pushing on the strip, for example. And this really gives us the hierarchy, the spectrum, right? So we have at zero, this is the full course model we have. At four iteration, we had the full fine physics model, but we can actually choose to be in between here. Then we also tried to do this for multiple objects. So here, there's again the same pusher, and the more transparent positions of the objects are the initial positions. But basically, we wanted to also predict how objects, the multiple objects, when they are in interaction, moves. And so here, instead of using a hand-coded course model, just like we did, we actually trained a neural network offline using the simulator. Basically, using the simulator, we pushed these objects many, many times, and then we trained a physics model, a neural network, which we then used as a course model. So you use the course model that you trained using your simulator. For example, you trained this using Mujoko. And then as the fine model, you use Mujoko itself, and then you can make Mujoko run at different accuracy levels using parallel in time integration, right? So we showed that actually, again, we can run Mujoko faster than it would actually run using the course model that we trained over Mujoko, and for some tasks, it would be fine for us. Okay, so of course, there are many open questions here. First of all, the models, the course models that I have talked about are only planar pushing models. So one question is, how can we have more general course models? If I want to run Mujoko with a course model that can capture all of Mujoko, everything that can happen in Mujoko, right? So that then I can run basically Mujoko, but at different accuracy levels in a robust way, and I can trade off speed with accuracy in a much better way. How can I come up with those course models to then do this is an important question. At a more technical level, one thing that we didn't do was GPU parallelization. I'm very interested in doing that next. We were only able to parallelize this over CPU cores until now. So we actually didn't really benefit from the full potential of this, because the more parallel cores you have, the more parallel runs you have, the faster our predictions can possibly be. But at a more higher level, I also want to say that, like, you know, I think, you know, until now I am mostly focused on this hierarchy in terms of the accuracy, right? So if you go higher in the hierarchy, you have less accuracy, and as you go lower, you have more accuracy. But I think the idea of having a hierarchy of physics models go beyond accuracy. I think if you want to, you know, going back to that example that I had at the beginning, if you want robots to be able to really perform physics-based manipulation, I think we do not only need fine and coarse models in terms of accuracy, but we also need physics models that can run on lower dimensional representations of the physics of the sea, either lower dimensional, or you can say lower resolution, and this also applies to obviously deformable objects as well. And if we can, only if we can do that, I think we will be able to crack this big problem of computational expense of running forward physics models. And if we can do that, I think, you know, one thing we can do very well is task adaptive planning. This is what we call this idea of finding the right model for a given task and not going any finer than that, because the task doesn't require it, right? But even if you have a task that is, you know, very delicate, so you really need to go all the way down to the fine model, this kind of a hierarchy can still be useful, because you can do hierarchical planning, right? You can first use the coarse model to generate a coarse plan, which you can then initialize with the finer model and initialize the finer model. So, you know, even if you're going all the way down, you can still use the hierarchy. And I think this can also be very useful for state estimation and perception as well. We, since we have been working, I have worked with Sid on, Herb, and since then, you know, the way we do perception and state estimation didn't change much in these kind of scenes. We have a camera, it looks at the scene, it tries to estimate the poses of the objects, right? But actually, if you want to have physics-based interaction, we need to have, I think, a much more Bayesian tracking, Bayesian filtering kind of approach to this, where we actually track all these objects over time. And if you want to do Bayesian estimation, we need also system dynamics model, in addition to the observations coming from camera or contact sensors, whatever sensors we are using. And the thing is, we have been able to use Bayesian estimation in robot navigation and localization because, you know, the forward model there is quite simple, odometry, right? And integrating odometry is super fast. So you can just do that. But here in these kind of environments, the problem with using Bayesian estimation, like, you know, if you want to run particle filtering like algorithm here, one problem is it is much higher dimensional than simple robot localization. So you need even a higher number of particles. Second is that your forward model is much, much more expensive. It is running a physics engine instead of integrating odometry. I think if we can have these coarse physics models, they can also be used for state estimation. And the thing is that the state needs to estimate the coarse, and the estimator needs to estimate the coarse state that is going to be used by planning and control anyway. So everything can stay at that level. It doesn't need to go any beyond. So I think I really am excited about this idea of having a hierarchy of physics models, and I think that's the way I will explore in the future. And so that was about it about physics-based manipulation. I should acknowledge first of all Wisdom Agbo, my PhD student, who actually did the work on this, and for the parallel in time integration methods, we collaborated with Daniel Ruprecht, who's from Technical University of Hamburg. He's an applied mathematician. He's not a roboticist, but he was an expert in these parallelized integration methods, and we implemented those methods together with him. Okay, so that was the physics-based object manipulation bit, and now I am going to the human-robot forceful collaboration. And just to remind you here, I was interested in tasks like this, where the robot holds the object for the human and the human applies sequences of changing forces because he's cutting on the object. And you know, some of the tasks, some of the problems we were interested in, this problem were, we were interested in planning grasps, right? So the human, as he's cutting here, he's applying forces upwards. So, you know, one thing we want the robot to do is to come up with the grasps that feel, resist those forces for some duration over the circle. But then, you know, after the humans are in here, and the forces will be applying downwards. So the robot should plan to leave this gripper, for example, and grasp the object from the bottom so that the object doesn't slide out of the grip, and it has support from the bottom. And then, you know, as the forces then go towards the right here, because that's how the human is moving the cutter there, you know, then this gripper moves to the side, right? So first of all, we were interested in this problem. How can we plan the sequence of grasps on an object when it is under changing forces? And we were interested in minimizing these number of grasps, right? So because you can keep changing the grasps every time the human moves a little, but you don't want to do that. You want to minimize the sequence of grasps. And you know what you don't want happening is, you know, unstable grasps where the object can slide, or you know, the object can bend, and things like that. Okay, and of course, like, it is not only about the sequence of grasps, but as you go from one grasp to the other, actually things can get unstable due to gravity. Like, for example, if you're going from this grasp where it leaves this, it removes this right grip, and then it wants to go to the bottom. If it just tries to do that at this configuration, then what can happen is that the object can droop in this gripper, right? So what you need to do then is to find configurations like this one here, where even if you let this go, the object will still be stable, and then you regrasp, and then you maybe move it back to its original configuration. And this was one problem that we worked on. We built a planner that basically first plans the sequence of grasps, and then it tries to come up with how to go from one grasp to the other by changing these individual grippers. And then these basically mean that there needs to be an intersection configuration where both the grasps are stable with respect to gravity. And then you know, all these grasps then define a constraint manifold under which you need to make plans and make sure everything connects to each other. Okay, and then we build a planner like that for this task. And you know, as we built the planner, actually we realized that we are kind of resolving a problem that Tim Breton solved about 15 years ago, where he was looking at the spider robot climbing, and the robot needs to put its feet onto these supports, and it needs to decide which support to put it on. And this is very much similar to our grasps, which grasp we want to have. And you know, as the robot moved from one configuration to the other to then be able to move its feet, were like our plans of the moving the object so that we can then change the gripper on the object. So you know, basically very traditional multimodal planning problem. And I think, you know, it was great to see that these core ideas of multimodal planning are very, very fruitful. They apply to so many different problems if you look at it the right way. One different thing that we had here was that we wanted to actually minimize these number of grasps, as I mentioned. And you know, we did that in a quite a straightforward way, really. So we discretized these forces given the task, and this was given to the planner. Okay, so the sequence of forces are given to the planner. That's an input to the planner. And then, you know, let's say this is the configuration space, and then given one of the forces, let's say F1, you know, let's say this red region here is the stable configurations of the robot, like this one, for example, against that force, okay? And then, you know, the green region is the stable configurations against another force, and then, you know, the blue region is against Fi. Now, the thing is, you can pick the configuration Q1 for the first force and Q3 for the second force, but you don't want to do that. You ideally want to hit these intersections, right? Because then you are minimizing your the number of configurations and grasps that can resists to multiple sequences of forces. And for that, we basically created a graph where we would have these configurations. So given the first force, we would sample from the stable configurations, and given the second force, we would sample from the configurations. And then these costs between these nodes were determined by how many groupers the robot needs to move to go from one configuration to the other. So for example, Q2 being stable against both F1 and F2, is in both F1's column and F2's column, and the cost is zero because, you know, you don't pay any price. But then you can do a shortest path search on this, and then it gives you a sequence of graphs that cover all the applied forces, right? Now, and then we built this system to resist those forces, and it would you know, tell the human that, you know, cut until this point, and then, you know, I want to regrasp, and then it would change the regrasp, and you know, Baxter is not very accurate, so, you know, the student has to help it. Okay, so, but notice that the object is always at the same place here. So we then asked ourselves, okay, if you want to make this comfortable for the human, and realize that actually it is sometimes very difficult and uncomfortable for the human when the object is always at the same place and the human is trying to, for example, cut a circle. And one question we started asking is, okay, if we want to optimize this for the human comfort, how can we do that? So we started working with some biomedical engineers who knows more about the skeletal and muscular structure of the human body and how we can estimate and measure them. And we determined two tasks, okay? So we pick the task of puncturing, which is basically just with a sharp tool, puncturing a hole in a thick foam like this. That was one task. And then a cutting task, which is when you start from one square to the other square, you basically cut it. And this is a thinner board, but it's a cutter. And for these two tasks, we devised a planner where the input to the planner is the relative position of the human with respect to the robot. And this was during the experiments captured by mocap. And another input to the planner is where you want to apply, like where the human wants to apply the operation, and an estimate of the force as well. Okay, so we offline, we measured these forces and we approximated the force that should be expected at the interaction. And that was also input to the planner. And then the output of the planner is a robot configuration and a grasp on the object. So something like this to hold the object for the human. But, you know, it needed to satisfy different constraints. One constraint here is the regular stability of the object and the robot's joints, right? So you don't want the object to slip through or bend. Also, you don't want to apply too high torques to the robot joints. But more interestingly, more importantly here, the planner also tried to minimize the predicted human muscle activity, okay? Given the pose of the object. Now, given the pose of the object, the thing is that the human muscle activity depends on the human configuration, right? The human's geometric configuration. And then given that, you can actually try to predict the muscle activity. But then there's lots of redundancy in how the human chooses their configuration. So we had to make a choice here. We could have resolved this in different ways, but what we did was we assumed that the human chooses the configuration at which they minimize the muscle activity as well, okay? So this was basically minimizing over minimizing, so it wasn't very efficient, but we assumed that the human chooses the configuration that minimizes the muscle activity, and based on that assumption, we picked the object pose that will lead to the minimum muscle activity. Okay, so we divide this planner, it positions the object, and then we did experiments. We basically put all those markers so that the robot knows about the position of the human. And then these are EMG sensors that our biomedical engineering collaborators helped us with to target certain relevant muscles here put them on and perform these experiments. And then we measured them, okay? And when we measured them, we basically looked at three planners. So it says baselines here, but actually this one, like, you know, one was our planner, right? We call it comfort planner. And this is one example for puncturing, you know, this is the way it positioned it for a puncturing task, for example. Another baseline one baseline was a random planner. It randomly chooses a feasible configuration. And another baseline was what we called user-defined pose. If you have played with Baxter, you might know that you can hold the cuffs and then move it. So basically, in this case, we ask the user to hold Baxter's cuffs and move the object to a position which is comfortable for, which they think will be comfortable, and then perform the operation. And, you know, almost in all cases, they just came up with this very canonical configuration. We did this for puncturing, we did this for cutting as well, and these are same planners and you know, example positions of these poses. And, you know, I wasn't very hopeful about this because, you know, we are making lots of assumptions about what the human will choose. And then, you know, these muscular models, you know, will they, how accurate they are. And then these EMG sensors are extremely noisy. If you look at the data that you get from them, you know, I was like, it can't be that there's anything useful here. And for cutting, there wasn't. So for cutting, really, when we looked at the data here, what we have are all the data from different subjects. The subjects are letters, so C is one subject, and all these points are different trials with the subject C. And the color is the planner, okay? So the blue color is our planner, the gray one is the random planner, and the red one is the user-defined pose. And the horizontal axis is the muscle activity, what we mostly care. So we want to be to the left side of this, but we also measured the force, okay? Even though we had an estimate of it, we still wanted to measure, but, you know, what we really care about is the muscle activity. And when we looked at this, you know, the regions and we color these regions here. So you will see a blue color, red color region, and gray color region. We remove the outliers out of three standard deviations, and then we create a region out of it. So, and when you looked at them, like, you know, yeah, like they are kind of overlapping. And when we did the statistical significance test to this, like, you know, there wasn't any significant result of it all between the three planners, okay, with the cutting. But with puncturing, actually, we did get good results. So we consistently got very small, lower muscular activity with the puncturing, and which overlap with the user defined, but the user defined poses did cover a larger area. So they were sometimes good, but sometimes the users didn't actually predict what will be useful and comfortable for them. And then the random was much worse in general. You know, we actually at least show in principle that it was possible to actually use these biomechanical models to predict and use them. So finally, some open questions here. As you've seen, like, you know, the first pure robotic planner I described was more dynamic. It was thinking about sequences of tasks and moving the object, but the human predictive one was actually quite static, right? So we are still thinking about, okay, how then do we extrapolate to the dynamic tasks? And there are two sub-questions here. One is how to predict muscle activity when the task is more dynamic, because actually it is much more difficult to do that, to predict. And we think that this may be one of the reasons why cutting has failed, because, you know, puncturing is very much similar to a static task. The hand doesn't move that much. You're basically applying a force at a certain point, but with cutting, it was moving a lot. And then our assumptions about the static configurations were really failing there. That is one reasoning we have. And then finally, a second question here is that how to then plan the continuous interaction given such predictions about the human's dynamic response, right? So we still are looking into this, and we don't yet have the result. And this work was by Luis Figueredo, who was a postdoctoral researcher with me, and then Lipeng Chen, my PhD student, and Rafael Agar and Samit Chakrabarty were the biomedical engineering team that we collaborated on this. And I will conclude. I just want to say, you know, I talked about Louis Lipang and Wisdom's work, but actually, you know, there are other work that goes on in the lab from Wisdom, who finished his PhD, defended his viable just 2 weeks ago, and Raphael, mostly on object physics-based manipulation as well. But I had to pick something to present, so I didn't go into detail, but I'm happy to chat about those as well. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. We have time for a few questions.
I'll go. Yeah, I thought you were raising their hand. Mehmet, in the first part of the talk, mm-hmm. With the parallel, the parallelization. Yeah. So the reason at four, so you were splitting into four, and then the reason that at four iterations, basically, it was the same as doing that four is the same. That's the number, right?
Yes.
Okay. So Dan, have you explored the trade-off of, you know, binning it smaller and doing more parallel threads, where you're able to do more iterations until it becomes as expensive as doing the full thing versus like that four parameter?
That's the thing. Until now, we did only eight cores, really. And that was because that is the thing that I mentioned about the GPU parallelization. So that is... we weren't able to get Mujoco to run on different GPU cores. And, you know, one thing that I actually wanted to ask Dieter at some point was whether the NVIDIA physics can be run on GPU cores independently so that we can actually massively parallelize this. Because, you know, I want to be able to try massively parallelizing this and then try it and see what we get out of it. Of course, like, you know, with this parallel in time integration thing, you don't like, you know, there's a sweet spot. You can't just keep parallelizing and expect to gain. But I think, you know, it is much more than four or eight, really. Yeah.
Maybe I can chime in because you mentioned that.
Yeah.
So there's, I think, especially Isaac, the GIM version, is highly parallelized, and they did some experiments, for example, on, you know, the OpenAI experiments with the hand and the cube models. And they get dramatic speed ups by just running RL in parallel then even, right? It's not just running the simulation, but the whole RL algorithm. It makes a huge difference. So that would be interesting to investigate.
Yeah.
I actually have a question related to that. What I didn't fully understand is how you stitch these pieces then together when you do the fine simulation. Is there some, because let's say the second step fine simulation starts at the wrong start point, kind of, right? Is there some assumption of how you can?
So now this is like, you know, you do the first course prediction and then you do the fine. So now you are here, right? Mm-hmm. Now what you do is you then run your course model forward again and you ask the question, okay, so you start here. So this first slice after the first iteration do not change because you have solved it, right? Yeah. So, but let me still explain. So what you do is you now start from the new point, which didn't change in this case, but you run the course model forward again, okay? And then you take the difference between the new course prediction and the old course prediction, and then add it on top of the fine prediction. In this case, the old course prediction and the new course prediction are the same. So when you add it on top of the fine, you end up at the same point. Then you come to the second step, okay? What you do is you then run from here the course prediction forward, okay? So now you end up here, right? That if you run the course model, if it's just static, like in this example, you just move it forward and you end up here. Now you look at the difference between this new course prediction and the previous course prediction, and there is that much difference. And then you take that and you add it on top of the fine prediction, okay? And that gives you your estimate of that second point. And then you just keep doing that.
So that was my question. So you assume there's some kind of shift, let's say, in state space you can apply, and the prediction is still at least similar, right? Because I guess it might get tricky when you have contacts or something that are within one, right?
That's a very good point. Yes. So one thing that we had to do actually, because we applied it to contact, was And you know, our applied mathematician collaborator was like, yeah, that's an interesting issue. Was that when we made these updates, objects could get into each other, right? So what we had to do then was to project them back to out of contact states. We had to actually extend the method a bit like that.
Okay,
that's true. Yeah,
very cool. Thank you.
Yeah.
I had a quick sort of another follow-up. So this is akin to sort of multiple shooting methods for solving two-point boundary value problems, right? So you can look at like collocation methods where you split time into pieces, and then you're doing multiple shooting along the way.
Okay.
So I'm familiar with this in the trajectory optimization literature. The higher order question was, you're starting with something coarse and you're making it iteratively more refined,
yeah,
all the way across from one to end. Was when I think about it for planning or in search, if I'm closing the loop in terms of model predictive control, then I'd imagine that I'd want higher resolution in the short horizon because that's where stuff is happening, and progressively lower resolution in the long horizon, because that's where, you know, things are more speculative, both in terms of stochasticity, both in terms of everything else, right? Like if you think about search, we use heuristics to tell us where the sort of further out duration is. And I was then trying to see whether I could modify this method such that I could get a behavior like that. It seems like there's nothing here that prevents me from doing that, where
it
I can do iterative refinement.
It actually does it. It's already like that. So the thing is, if you look at it, after the first iteration, until the time point one here, you do have the fine prediction, right? You do have the fine prediction, and that is the most immediate time point in front of you. So so you have already solved it. You have already integrated from your initial point the define model. And then once you do the forward propagation, actually it is the case that your accuracy with respect to the underlying function you're trying to approximate is smaller towards the beginning of the time.
Correct, horizon. Yeah. My point being that you can do this iteratively in waves. Like you can have a wave that's running that is at resolution like K, begin wave K plus one even before wave K has ended, right? Like you presented it as like you end the wave K, you commence wave K plus one, but it seems like you could just keep running these waves in parallel because the effects don't backprop, they just forward prop.
Yep. They do this when they do parallel in time integration. This is pipelining. They call this mm-hmm. pipelining, which makes sense.
Yep.
So you can actually pipeline these predictions so that you can make even better use of the available cores, because you can do that. So,
thank you so much. And thank you all for coming. And thanks for staying up late, Mehmet.
No, it's not that late. Okay. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.